and there's no precedent for such a large-scale development on that around your Corkhill Road. The topography and elevated position are problematic, and we are concerned that there will be significant loss of intrusion, loss of privacy, and will be an overbearing, overshadowing impact on the surrounding properties. It's the brightest view that the application will be, if it's granted, will be a great disservice to the neighbourhood, and I would urge the committee to decline the proposal.
Site stays, building line stays as out. So the 100% affordable housing will be secured through the Section 26 agreement, which will require a detail to be agreed and signed off before the commission's release.
Thank you, Chair. I welcome Mr. Wilkins. Okay, I think affordable housing provision is needed in Heswall as much as is needed in the East of it. And the Commissioner has a consensus that I'd like to move accept recommendations.
I also went on the site visit last week and I welcomed some of the assurances that have been given, such as the fact that all the luggage engines, etc., are going to be kept. And we're talking about, I think, 100% affordable housing. It's not being built on green belt land, but it's ticked all the boxes. I see no reason at all why we should object to the proposal, and I'm more than happy to support it. Thank you, Chair.
Okay. I think when we're about the site visits, it is located fairly high, and are those bushes underneath the entrance to it. PENSBY Road does have other flats, developments on it. Just for you, really, that the houses on Radnor and Pearl Hill were set back sufficiently, in my view. And the officer's report advises us that all the necessary interface distances between the developments and those properties are met. I did have some sympathy with the argument that there wasn't much in the way of amenity space as required, potentially under our development. But you know, it occurred to me that the developer could take the application away, they could take away all the car parking space there and just rest it over, and that would meet the requirements of both our amenity space and actually the requirements of our parking policies, which only require maximum values and do not set a minimum. I think our balance, given the photographs that we were shown, it will probably be more desirable for provision of off-street parking to be provided on the site, and it is being provided on the site. So in terms of what the developers could all get, we could send them away and say, put more grass on the site, more meeting space for the sole use of residents, and they will be able to do that without altering the mass of the building just by simply taking away the car parking spaces, and it would still abide by our parking policies. So for our balance, I think the point made that parking is an issue there. It would be better for 32 cars to be accommodated on the site. So having weighed that aspect up, I have to say that I've come to the conclusion that the lack of amenity space, in fact, that doesn't comply with policy, some of our policies there, I think I can live with because of the off-street parking that's given and because of the fact that it's a social housing. I don't think it's particularly out of character with PENSBY Road. I've heard a recommendation for approval. Is that seconded? That's a good one, Mike Kelly. Can I see those in favour of that? Okay, from the public for Heswall Gospel Hall, our application has been approved unanimously. Moving to agenda item 6, this is land to the rear of 103-105 Seabank Road, to the rear of 4850 Pegg Road, LISCARD. The officer would give a presentation.
Okay, so permission is sought for the erection of a pair of semi-detached dwellings to the rear of 48 and 50 Penkett Road and 103 and 105 Seabank Road. The application is an outline application, however, scale, design, layout and access are to be determined at this stage, with landscaping reserved for subsequent approval. The site is currently vacant and overgrown and is not directly linked to any of the adjacent properties. The two new dwellings will sit side on the rear elevations of 48 and 50 Penkett Road and 103 and 105 Seabank Road. The side elevations of the new properties will be blank and the minimum separation distance of 14 metres is achieved in relation to adjacent properties. A distance of 10 metres is achieved from the rear elevation of the new dwellings to the rear boundary, which meets the minimum garden depth sought for new developments. The access will require widening at Penkett Road with the resighting of the pillars, and this is conditioned as part of any approval. The proposed development would not impact on amenity or the character of the area, and there are no highways objections to the scheme subject to the pillars being resighted. The proposals would make effective use of a site that does not currently contribute to the area and is recommended for approval. There is a qualifying petition of objection.
Is there a representative of the petitioners here?
Criterion 2 states that the proposed development, including its access, does not result in detrimental change to the character of the area, nor result in undue noise, disturbance, loss of privacy, or sense of enclosure affecting adjoining residents. The application site is sandwiched between existing housing fronting Seabank Road and Penkett Road, with a 40 metre plus long private access driveway. It is proposed to provide two semi-detached houses over three storeys. The front and rear elevations have windows and glazed doors at second and third storey level that will overlook the rear gardens of numerous properties. From the rear elevation, 50 to 54 Penkett Road, and from the front, 105 to 111 Seabank Road. In addition, as the design includes bay windows for the front and rear, there is direct overlooking into 48 and 50 Penkett Road and 103 and 105 Seabank Road. The proposed access runs adjacent to number 44 Penkett Road. The introduction of traffic and comings and goings will have a severe detrimental impact on number 44 and number 48 Penkett Road. As the proposed means of access and pedestrian access runs adjacent to and alongside full length of both plots. The application proposal, including the means of access, will have an adverse impact on numerous occupiers and properties on both Penkett Road and Seabank Road, harmful to their amenity, increased noise and disturbance from comings and goings, and a severe loss of privacy, particularly with regard to the use and enjoyment of their private rear garden space. Criterion 3 of Policy HS10 states that proposed access must be at least 3 metres wide, with amenity strips to one or both sides, and adequate passing places. The access must be properly formed and hard surfaced with adequate sight lines and visibility displays at its junction with the existing road. It should not have a seriously detrimental effect on the existing street scene or highway safety. The proposed access driveway is only 2.75 metres wide at its entrance and has more pinch points along its length. No passing places, no amenity or service strips, and no buffer between between traffic and number 44 or 48 Penkett Road. In order to meet the above standard, a minimum width of 4 metres will be required to accommodate passing spaces and amenity or service strip. A 4 metre width is required in accordance with SPG 10 as referred to on a similar scheme on tonight's agenda. Now that's just been withdrawn because I think the application was approved. The application I'm referring to.
You have one moment.
Sorry, it's a straight grade, and what we're saying is it ought to be assessed on the same basis and apply the same policy tests. Condition 6 states no development shall take place until the brick pillars at the entrance of the site have been removed and the access widened to 3.2 metres. The brick pillars are not in control of the applicant and the scheme cannot be implemented. Furthermore, the requirement to widen the access to 3.2 metres would include land beyond the scope of the red edge boundary, outside the scope of the application. The applicant does not serve a certificate B notice. I'd also point out the location plan on the screen is wrong, it's not the right plan. And also the proposed site plan is incorrect. It includes, it doesn't show the bay window to the front and rear, another error. Finally, we would say that residents have concerns that the access is substandard. No safe visibility space has been demonstrated, and the access will not accommodate a bin truck or fire tender. The application proposal does not meet all 6 criteria attached to using pre-policy 10. Therefore, planning permission ought to be reviewed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Last
members, if
there
are any questions for the
agents. These pillars, from the previous speaker, you whoever actually owns these pools in order for the they just access to be
resolved. This is an outline application, and one of the conditions is that the issue of the widening of the access because of these pillars blocking the driveway would be determined as part of the requirements of the permissions condition.
The answer is yes, they have spoken to the owners, the owner has refused.
Okay.
I own them. I've not spoken to anyone.
If you have a look to the condition 6 in the report, the conditions that the entrance needs to be of a certain size. And as you mentioned in the previous application, land ownership issues don't come into it from planning point of view. If land ownership can't be secured, clearly then the condition can't be discharged. But that is not a matter for us to determine whether the site itself will take 2 houses.
Thanks, Chair. I wasn't wearing the ownership of the pillars, but I think we're given that the actual availability of the scheme actually revolves around these pillars being moved. I would have thought, personally speaking, it would be useful to resolve that for against planning, so then that we've got a clear the accessibility issues that have been resolved before
against planning. If we could go back to that moment, because it's obviously a question, we have to give that to the to. Any other questions for the applicant? Thank you very much for your presentation. Again, I didn't see a full council, but I'll just double check that was correct. Excellent. Before we open to members, I'll turn to officers to answer the public's steward's release and the public's
okay, thank you, Chair. In the officer's report, paragraphs 3.91, 3.92 largely deal with this issue of the access road and the pillars. I think it's acknowledged that if the pillars can't be addressed, then it's likely we would refuse the application because safe access can be provided to the site. Hence, condition 6, which is a pre-commencement condition requiring the pillars, the issues of the pillars to be resolved. As the Chair has already said, subsequently if that can't be resolved and the access can't be achieved, then the development won't be able to move forward.
Well, we can resolve the issue tonight. I own the pillars and it won't be moved.
Okay. So that's a private matter between landowners and bizarre as it may sound, it's not a material planning consideration. Any other contributions
out
from members of the Chair?
Thanks, Chair. Looking at the conditions, obviously the fire authority, as I said, they will be able to access the site because of access limitations. But one of the conditions is that domestic fire suspicion system be installed. I'm just saying, you see in the conditions that systems should be installed, and see nothing about what standard it should be up to, or how it should be maintained. Because, for instance, to me, 10 years down the road, if we get a private individual buys the property and doesn't maintain the suspicion system to extend it or disables it, or whatever, then the fire service might be more difficult to tackle any incidents in those properties. So I'd be just interested in what standards exist in terms of fire suspicion.
Any other issues? Again, another bizarre thing. I've looked at the building regulations so far as fire is concerned, and the issue of access is certainly there. This is the reason for condition number 6, to ensure that the access meets the requirements of the fire service. The fire service has not objected, it has just said that this is what it needs. And I do fear that there needs to be a closer alignment between some of our planning policies and things like the building regulations. Because again, we're advised that issues of building regs is a matter for the building regulation enforcement team and not material planning consideration. what you think, you know, if you're not meeting the building regs, then really you shouldn't be meeting the private policy, should you? So we can get those a little bit closer aligned as we move into the new local plan, that would be, I think, useful to me. But again, it doesn't necessarily mean we ought to refuse it if we can condition it. And that's going to be like the national guidance is not to refuse applications if you can condition it. Now, if the condition can't be discharged, then it can't be discharged. That's not a matter for us. That's certainly any other comments from members?
Right, can I just talk us through this a little? I'm a little bit perplexed by this one. It's clear we have, I think it's page 10 that the objector referred to, where it's quite clear it says that the private drive of 3 metres width with amenity strips to one on both sides with adequate passing places. We've heard from one of the comments from the audience that that won't be the case. It's clear that it's not wide enough to have passing places regardless of whether the pillars at the front of the proposed or. So it's really how much weight do we give to this, and if this application is approved tonight, the applicant then has to apply for detailed planning permission, having received outline planning permission, and prove to us at that stage that he has access. Is that correct?
No. The application is in outline. The opening one matter is reserved for subsequent approval, and that is the landscaping. Access is included in this application, so the access details would be approved as part of this application if it's approved.
Okay,
okay.
I'm sorry to be a bit thick here, but I understood from the comments that were made that the ownership of the pillars and whether they would be removed could be decided later through negotiation to enable this application to go ahead. What you're saying is if we approve this tonight, that's irrelevant and the application can go ahead.
There are two separate issues here.
Yeah.
There's the issue about the access and who controls it, who owns it, and what needs to be done to make the access accessible, if you like. So we're saying, as set out in the report, that if the pillars are moved, the access becomes accessible, and therefore the use of the land is an acceptable use of the land. If the pillars can't be moved, for whatever reason, then the development can't go ahead, because the condition that's set out it can't be complied with.
Okay.
Okay.
Through you, Chair, I understand that means that basically if we approve the application, the pillars, as the gentleman says, he owns the pillars, won't give the gentleman who wants to build a house access, can't discharge the condition, so he can't build it whether we give planning permission anyway. But the point I would want to make slightly is, would it be reasonable to assume that if the gentleman doesn't give permission for the pillars to be removed, that there is no way you could get a car in that small turning anyway? It's whether or not, of course, that we enforce a condition not being met. So if you grant planning permission and the pillars don't come down and you build them, I said he's built them without discharging condition 6, but we then take enforcement action and have the houses built without planning permission, because he didn't comply with condition 6, that would happen. Because the danger is that somebody gets planning permission, does not comply with the conditions, and then enforcement doesn't take action, and so he gets his planning permission in effect by default.
I sort of see what you're saying. The condition is a pre-commencement condition, so the applicant must comply with that condition before any development commences. I hear what you're saying, there is an element of risk that the development will take place without compliance with that condition, and that's where enforcement comes in. And as members will know, we have a source of our enforcement team, so we are able to take more proactive enforcement. in terms of the highways, because my understanding was that there was an objection from you if it wasn't for the access of the hills.
Thank you, Chair. That's right. There is obviously the pinch point that we were concerned with initially, and that's why we laid with the planning officers to put in as pre-commencement condition. In terms of the width of the road, it is 3.2 metres for the majority of the access road up to where it widens out, as well as proposed. Given the sort of volumes of traffic that will be generated, we don't consider that use of existing access would be unsafe. We only expect only a sort of negligible increase in the number of vehicle conflicts along the access drive, and those people that live there will be familiar with the layout.
To you, Chair, would it be reasonable under the circumstances to refuse the application under HS 10.3 that the proposed access is of insufficient width to provide a private drive 3 metres width of community streets on one side, blah blah blah. So could we move refusal under HS 10.3 on that alone? On the access, because as it stands at the moment, it doesn't have HS 10.3.
I mean, obviously that is a gift of the committee, so if you felt that the application didn't meet HS 10.3, then yes, you can refuse it on that.
And would you consider that refusal on HS 10.3 would be adequate? On that condition alone,
bearing
in mind the conversation that's gone on.
It is a difficult one. I think when we assess the application, we've come down on balance that it's acceptable. I mean, clearly there are some issues with the access. Highways have raised them, and we've looked at those as well. But subject to the conditions that are listed, we felt that our balance, those issues could be overcome. And that doesn't mean the committee has to agree with us on that. And, you know, it could be something that is subsequently tested on field.
Thanks, Chair. When I asked the question about any what standards can be applied when it says about suspicion and also maintenance requirements, and I know it's just no way people haven't looked up in the paper, just wondering if you can sort of view this.
Okay, I think the Chair did answer that question. It's a building regulations issue, really. The fire service responded to say that they had no objection to the application, subject to details that are contained within a building regs document. So we can't really have any regard to that as far as the planning application is concerned. It would be covered by any subsequent building regs. But just to cover that aspect, the condition is on there around supplying the appliances, but the detail of it would need to be put through building regs.
I'm just looking at an appeal decision that was recently sent to us. I had in the back of my mind that access was something that the inspector had looked at in terms of HS 10.1 that we referred to. It was much larger. It was about five dwellings with a single access road. On a certain width. So it's obviously larger than this one. And the appeal